Well, thank you for that introduction, and good afternoon, everyone. It's a real pleasure to be here. I'm going to read, a few science poems. I think there's a sense in which, because science is my background, it almost always comes into everything. So it's not necessarily science poems and not. But one of the ways in which science and poetry are supposed to be similar is that they both use metaphor or metaphorical thinking. So I'm going to start there. A short treatise on a squid. Overhead, yes, the shark hangs like a Renaissance saint, in whose eyes time falls like a sediment. And no doubt the machinations of a moray eel's jaws are more dangerous than teeth in a glass. And it is not grief that makes the upward filling mass of little bells, the jellyfish, drop again as a heart does into sorrow. But it's in the basements, deep and damp Atlantic, among the transparent skins of fish and the skeletons worn with a monstrous clarity, that the greatest exaggeration is made, as Vampiro Toothless Infernalis heaves into view. That name, it reminds me of Prudentius, who said the corruption of language is at the root of sin. Once Satan's tongue was split, object and name slid off one another, like function and form in a tumor, or lovers making and remaking their union, but still remaining alone. What crosses the divide is not itself, but what has found itself in another, an ecstasy of mind where like is like is like. Dear metaphor, read lover, we invented heaven, imagining sky as a fish might the land, alien, beautiful on our tongue. And that Vampiro Toothless Infernalis is the deep sea squid, and the name means vampire squid from hell. Which seems a bit unfair, really. I think it comes from that tradition of where people used to think that anything that was ugly was evil, and anything that was beautiful was godly, or in order to be godly, you had to be beautiful. How it is with a circle. Actually, it's just a line, but all points are equidistant from the center without distortion, and that's what makes it special. Contained by and within that line are all the attributes of circularity, the infinite exactitude of pi, a disk too correct to be a moon or an eye, though sure enough to be a wheel, a curve that is not a skull or a country's anxious border, but that untroubled arc the compasses draw, the black lead circle, stark and unbreached. But we haven't come nearly far enough. What does a circle become if you puncture it? All lines and rows and scars. Did Euclid consider this? Arcs rejoining to make circlets, their untethered balloons for a moment carrying rainbows as soap bubbles do. And the insides, all that was circle, seeping out into the circumambient air. What of desire? The body is drawn towards the shape of its perfect star, to be something else, to be something more. I think one of the things I often write about when I'm thinking about science is maybe the scientific method, and particularly that sort of old fallacy of objectivity. And physics tells us that there's no such thing as being truly objective. You know, we as the experimenter are affected by what we observe, and what we observe is affected by us. But I think it's still a pervasive kind of notion that we have, that somehow it's possible to exclude ourselves from the world. Drawing the ladder. If I look, there is no surface, no hinge, no bracket or screw, no line of aluminium, no striation to secure the foot rung by rung, no place the ladder gains the earth, no place the floating weight lands, no full part that is not obscured by shadows falling from the pepper tree or by old caked mud. Up to the thin leaves, up to the adornment of red peppercorns, there has been a year of standing, a year of ghost foot on ghost foot, angled to the tree and climbing. As the storms pass and the wind dies, then rises, as the air melts into an ancient insect busyness, as the still nights of swallows and wine ascend and decline, there has been this year of slow non-decay, of infinite definition. After which I come with charcoal in hand and cannot make anything connect. This next poem is I was having a bit of fun really. It's I was thinking about Neruda's odes, particularly his ode about lemons, you know, the lemonness of lemons, the cathedral of lemons. And I thought, isn't it a shame that our experience perhaps is not always as rich as that, particularly if we think of fruit as a commodity or buy it in the supermarket. So, modern fruit. One. The cherry ripens quickly. It becomes soft and brown. Then its skin splits, and the fungus takes off like a white head of hair on end with static. How sticky the bowl with its sugars. However cool the bowl, the cherry will not last. The decay is next to the china, and the cherries on top hide it beneath them with an imperial gloss. Two. These hard nectarines, apparently already ripened red. How illusory they are, tucked under the honest green-skinned bananas. What explains such flushed cheeks? Unripe and ripe, they look the same, though these will never share their beauty. False witnesses, they preen in the shade. No ode for you, little pharaohs. You will go straight from lie to rot. Okay, I'm going to read something else. It was interesting, Tanya saying about New Scientist. New Scientist is a really great source of stories, interviews, all kinds of information. This poem I wrote after reading an interview with the guy who survived Chernobyl. The engineer. We saw, just a few of us, most now dead, the laser of blue ionized air shining out of the ruins. It is a kind of violence, that light breaking through matter. It pulled Kademchuk into the rubble, and my God, it burns. It boils in the blood. The dosimeter hears it hissing. Yes, this beauty was difficult, as it rose from the pit of the reactor into the gash in the night sky. It isn't a new thought that we need both darkness and light. But when the explosion tore off the roof and the laser went up, scattering the seeds of gangrene, I knew it. We walked through wreckage like monks to their prayers. Now my sores split and cleave like atoms. The shine of things, of stuff, has cut me to the surface. Scientists, they're not unique in this sense, do tend to be rather obsessional. I met quite a few biologists who spent their entire life, to the exclusion of everything else, studying just one very specific animal, one specific insect or plant, or so on. And this poem is based on a true scientist who didn't just study catfish, she studied this particular catfish that's only found in the Amazon. They say it's rational to turn inwards to your obsession, to wake to it and love it. But I tell you, when the storms come down and the rain falls like stones onto the river, I can't open my eyes to its sting. My childless hip starts up its ache along the beltline where I hook my thumb. Then the waves come up over the canoe as if to drown me within reach of shore, and I have to think of where to jump to should a caiman land at my feet. But it passes, and then above the cataracts where the water eases and takes the rain like a boiling mirror instead, always a greater treasure of fish, and then a greater one still in the tiny creeks we call igarapes. And into that slow-moving catch, as bizarre as a netted dream, I sink my heart's current, the lines of its wonder tracing the body of my fish from the promontory of its ancient head to its long and breakable tail. I think I didn't give the title of that poem, did I? The Lover of Amazonian Catfish? I don't remember saying that. Okay, I'm going to read just two more. This one because I promised my son I would. He's still quite young, but he's just kind of getting the hang of the fact that, you know, Mummy has to go off and have adventures on her own sometimes. So this is to say thank you for letting me to come and do this one. Quickening. My son in his ancient world is swallowing dreams while my heartbeat entangles him. And he coils at my navel, the pendulums of his legs accruing bone, and his soft hands shuddering at his face as he gulps at seawater. He is for this short time a saint, getting ready to fall from concealment. His heel quivers, the body wakes upon jerking strings. Tiny snake soul, you are the first strong child to stir in me and stay bound. The globe of your head settles deeper at my pelvis. When they lift you out of me, you ascend in the too bright light. Your head black with blood, your toes like grains of cooked rice, and you curl in on yourself like a coral, the quenelle of your back gleaming. And then your cry goes up in astonished multiplication, and before they sew me shut with wire, it breaks the year open and enters me with its candelabra of vows. And I'm going to finish on this short one. For those of you who are kind of my age, it's an Elmer's Fire. It's not the film. It's the actual phenomenon I'm writing about here, which is the static discharge you get during storms. The Portuguese sailors used to call it the holy body. It's so bright. St. Elmo's Fire. As the charge from storm to mast consummates its stress in fire, so my mouth sings the lines of your body, and on that bridge of skin conceives our connection, our corpo santo, through the sign of a kiss. As hydrogen with hydrogen takes oxygen's hands in its own and shapes from those courtesies the soft machines of clouds, the bolts of summer rain, let's make again a sacredness from the bared world. The candles there are lit like the spears of Caesar's legion, luminous on the ramparts of the night. Thank you.